This video is going to be about the osteology of the proximal humerus. I've got the right humerus here, and it's from an anterior view. So starting off with the tubercles, this is the lesser tubercle, and the subscapularis, one of the rotator cuff muscles, attaches to the lesser tubercle. From this anterior view, you can see part of the greater tubercle, but you really need to turn it. Here's the lateral view. You can see how big the greater tubercle is. All of that is the greater tubercle. And the other rotator cuff muscles attach to the greater tubercle. On it, there are three facets. The superior facet for the supraspinatus, the middle facet for the infraspinatus, and then the inferior facet for the teres minor. So this is a posterior view of the humerus, and you can see the teres minor's attachment. So if I don't have a scapula with me, but imagine the teres minor fibers coming in like this to attach to the inferior facet, and the infraspinatus fibers coming in like this to attach the middle facet, and then the supraspinatus fibers coming in like this to attach to the superior facet. Between the two tubercles is a groove. It's called the intertubercular sulcus or bicipital groove, and the long head of the biceps brachii lies in that groove, the tendon of the long head of the biceps brachii. It's held in place by the transverse humeral ligament that spans the tubercles and the crests. The long head of the biceps brachii tendon is unique in that it goes into the shoulder joint capsule, so it's intra-articular, but extra-synovial. It has a synovial tendon sheath that surrounds it to reduce friction and enhance gliding, and that synovial tendon sheath communicates with the shoulder joint capsule. So the tendon lies in the groove, goes over superior to the humeral head, and then attaches on the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula and the superior labrum. If we follow or take our eye and follow the lesser tubercle distally, we see that there's a linear ridge, and that's the crest of the lesser tubercle, or it's called the medial lip of the intertubercular groove. This is where the teres major attaches. Then if we take our eye and follow the greater tubercle distally, and you can feel it too, this is the lateral lip of the intertubercular sulcus, or the crest of the greater tubercle. And that's where the pectoralis major attaches. On the floor of the groove, close to the medial lip, is where the latissimus dorsi attaches. Notice the relationship between the attachments of the internal rotators. Subscapularis is an internal rotator. Teres major is an internal rotator. Latissimus dorsi is an internal rotator, and the pectoralis major is an internal rotator. So if you imagine them pulling, it internally rotates the humerus. The humerus has two necks, an anatomical neck, which is here, which circumscribes the head. Humerus has a large head covered with articular cartilage. And then it has a surgical neck. The narrow part here is called the surgical neck, and that's a common site of fractures for the humerus. In your dissection, you'll notice the axillary nerve and the posterior humeral circumflex artery and veins, and they circumscribe the surgical neck, going posterior to the surgical neck and then coming out through the quadrangular space to innervate and supply the deltoid and the teres minor. Surgical neck fractures can potentially injure the axillary nerve and the posterior humeral circumflex vessels. Let's look at the, I'm going to zoom back out. At the posterior or lateral view, here's the deltoid tuberosity where the deltoid attaches. Then if I rotate the humerus for a posterior view, we can see and I can feel the radial groove. So on the posterior surface, about mid-shaft, is a shallow groove that runs from superior medial to inferior lateral on the posterior shaft of the feet of the humerus, and lying in that groove is the radial nerve and the profunda brachii artery, or the deep artery of the arm. Fractures of the mid-shaft of the humerus could injure the radial nerve and or the profunda brachii vessels, arteries, and veins. Okay, I think I'll end by talking about some ligament attachments on the humerus. Let's zoom in again. So starting with the coracohumeral ligament. The coracohumeral ligament is a thick ligament and goes from the coracoid process and then attaches to both the greater tuberosity and the lesser tuberosity. And the coracohumeral ligament, along with the superior glenohumeral ligament, which attaches about here, form a support for the long head of the biceps brachii, and it's described as the biceps pulley. So the coracohumeral ligament goes from the coracoid process, attaches to the greater tubercle, usually has two bands, greater tubercle and lesser tubercle, and then the long head of the biceps brachii goes between those two bands. The superior glenohumeral ligament attaches about here. The middle glenohumeral ligament attaches here. And then the inferior glenohumeral ligament, at least the anterior band of the inferior glenohumeral ligament, attaches down here. So notice how they're around the anatomical neck near the lesser tubercle. The capsule of the glenohumeral joint attaches to the anatomical neck, and we know that there's an axillary pouch or an axillary recess. And so when we look at this medial view of the humerus, the capsule dips, the attachment of the capsule dips down here in order to make that axillary pouch. Okay, I think that does it. Thank you.